salvation is anchored to your name. Saw your glory in the middle of the mess I made. You gave your life for me. Jesus, have your way. Your death erased my shame. Make my heart whole again. In you I find my rest. In you I find my victory. My soul will shout your praise forevermore. Forevermore, Jesus, forevermore, yeah. My salvation is anchored to your name. Saw your glory in the middle of a mess I made. You gave your life for me. Jesus, have your way. Your death erased my shame. Made my heart whole again.
And in you,
I find my rest. In you, I find my victory. My soul will shout your praise forevermore, forevermore. In you I find my strength. In you I find my victory. My soul will shout your praise forevermore, forevermore. Jesus, draw near our hearts to you now. We set free forever in your love. Draw near our hearts to you now. Forever in your love.
Draw near
our hearts to you now.
We set free
forever in your love.
Draw near
our hearts to you now. Forever in your love. In you I find my rest. In you I find my victory. My soul will shout your praise forevermore, forevermore. In you I find my strength. Find my victory. My hope is in your name. Forevermore, forevermore, forevermore.
Hello, good afternoon, and warm welcome to this afternoon session here at Merch and the MLFC or Miracle Life Family Church. So, special welcome to those who are joining for the very first time. We want to encourage you to like this session, invite friends to watch in the comment section. Please do let us know. We want to get your feedback. So, my name is Webster Twambo Jr., and I'm joined by a very special guest, my friend.
I'm at home. Shagun.
All right. Those who've been following this session, it's been on relationships and mentorship. So last week we looked at the need for a mentor. Why do you need a mentor? And we zeroed in on from that perspective. And then today we're going to look at another dimension in this series.
Yeah, so I think, thanks, Webster. I think today we're going to be continuing in our series. Last week we looked at why you need a mentor. This week we're going to be asking the question why you also should be a mentor, covering what we call the mentor mindset. Because we think if you understand the mentor mindset, it sets you up to be a mentor and to also understand how to interact with a mentor once you do get one. So to get started today, I think there's something we need to address from last week. We got a question from one of the young adults last week. And I'm going to just read the question so that we can address it before we go into the discussion for today.
Okay.
The question goes like this. Is there a way mentorship ends? Like, do you decide you don't need a mentor anymore, or will you be released from mentorship? I think that was an interesting one.
Yeah, it's quite interesting. And I must hasten to say, you know, mentorship is quite dynamic. All right? So last week we looked at purpose. Why am I entering into this mentorship relationship? So it's there should be that distinction between mentorship and coaching. So coaching usually is for a shorter period, and maybe you want to acquire a particular skill. But when it comes to mentorship, it's kind of an informal relationship, which is over a longer period of time. But having said that, there's a point where maybe you should not continue that mentorship relationship. It just depends on how that relationship is and the purpose for that. Because what we see from scripture is that, you see, like the Apostle Paul and Timothy, their relationship, we saw Paul at some point referring to Timothy, my son in the faith and the like. But then we see this relationship growing to a point where Paul calls Timothy my fellow servant. So as the mentee, or as the younger person or the less experienced is being mentored, they begin to grow. And it's a joy of the mentor to actually see this mentee doing stuff which as a mentor they are doing. So it kind of changes the dynamics of the relationship.
No, absolutely, you're right. I think in the mentorship relationship, we have to remember that it is not a mechanical relationship.
Yeah.
It is one that is based on, you know, the identification of potential. And we'll talk about a bit more about that. But you get to a point, and I think it's a mentor's joy to be able to recognize that you are maybe not even equals, but you grow.
Yeah, absolutely.
You grow to the point where that relationship can move from mentor mentee maybe to just friends.
Yeah, absolutely.
You
know?
And you continue to learn the experience. Yeah. So I think it's unique for everyone.
Yeah, it's unique. I remember at one point, the Lord Jesus, the greatest mentor, called his disciples, "Now I call you friends."
Yeah.
I think when you reach that level, it's really kind of, you're proud as a mentor that, you know, I've helped these guys grow and to this level. All right. So we are going to pick it up from that perspective now in terms of the mentor mindset. And I think, like we are saying, Shego, when we look at the greatest mentor, the Lord Jesus Christ, in John chapter 14, verse 12, let me just read this to you. Scripture says, "I tell you the truth. Anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done, and even greater works, because I'm going to be with the Father." So here, I've seen a lot of people who, especially who are insecure, they try to protect their base, and they really don't want anyone to kind of do things that they are doing. And they try by all means just to protect that their domain. But what we see from the Lord Jesus Christ is that he's expecting the people that he's mentoring or the people he's leading to actually do things that he does. And he's even, he even says, greater works or things shall you do than what I've done. So the mentor mindset is to, you know, create a platform or to identify potential and be able to nurture that potential. And even if that mentee begins to do things you do, or even greater things, you take joy as a mentor. And, you know, I'm reminded of what Miles Monroe says. You know, he says, the greatest act of leadership is mentorship. No matter what you have achieved as a person, if you fail to raise another person, then you have failed.
That's absolutely true. And when I think about, you know, the person who's listening to this today, the young adults who are listening to this today, that level of leadership, I think, is something everyone should aspire to.
Yeah.
You know, but the question you may ask is, so how can I start mentoring others? I mean, maybe I only learned that, I need a mentor last week. And now you're coming to me this week and saying, you should have a mentor mindset. So how can you start mentoring others?
Yeah, so what we see from scripture, Shegwin, and I like that, because what we see from scripture is, in fact, we can check this from Acts chapter 16, verse 2, of how Paul was able to identify potential, all right? So a mentor, you know, as you interact with everyone else, you should be able to identify potential. And when you identify, you know, for me, there are young people whom, after interacting with them, I just see a lot of potential. And I mark them, say, this one, I need to be part of the success story. And then I just kind of try to pull them from the crowd and then begin to pour out myself and just help them begin to realize that potential.
So the first thing from what you're saying you must do is that you identify somebody who has potential. And I like that scripture that you talked about. It says Acts 16:2, Timothy was well thought of by the believers.
Yeah.
So there was a good report about him.
Good report.
And then from there, Paul believed, I can help and mold and shape this young man. And I believe truly every one of us have people in our lives by virtue of our relationship with them, by virtue of, you know, home relationships, church relationships, even school or work, people that we can identify good potential in. And basis on how, you know, we are growing in the faith, we're growing as individuals, we can start to contribute to them.
Absolutely. And then, you know, as a beneficiary of mentorship, you know, last week I gave one example of how, you know, the role that mentors played in my life.
Yeah.
For instance, that big decision of deciding who I should marry, right? Because scripture says in the multitude of counsel, in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. All right. So, being a beneficiary or having appreciated what mentorship is, so it's also my responsibility to also mentor others.
Absolutely.
So I can avail myself, or having people that have walked up to me, then I can be able to avail myself to mentor others.
So if I could just, you know, sort of put it in context for you.
Yeah.
You know, when you identify potential, or when you find somebody who is of good report, who you believe you can help shape and mold, you know, and then of course, like you said, upon request of somebody who looks up to you, you know, people could look up to you in whatever sphere of life and walk up to you and ask you, it's an opportunity you shouldn't pass up.
Yeah. And in fact, it's very important for young people to, you know, for me, I was this zealous young man, you know.
Yeah, I'm not changed much, but go ahead.
Because of, you see, when I look at where I wanted to be, I didn't want to make mistakes.
Okay.
And I was pushing these people that I was looking up to, these people who were inspiring me. Because remember, I think in my view, Shegu, you know, mentee, given a small window, they need to maximize that opportunity. If you find someone who just opens the window for them to mentor you, I think you need, it's an opportunity that you need to grab.
No, absolutely. So, you know, you should make yourself available.
Absolutely.
For this opportunity. Yeah. So, Webster, just taking the conversation a bit further now. So, what are the different types of mentoring that anyone who wants to say, okay, now I'm ready to mentor?
Mentoring is so dynamic. All right? So, there could be the traditional one-on-one mentorship, which is very common.
Yeah.
Yeah. You engage your mentor in one-to-one. There also can be by distance, right? Maybe your mentor is based in a different location, you're in a different location, then it's by distance. It can also be a group mentorship where you know, it's a group of people, and then you have sessions when you meet, and then from there you then you agree objectives or what to do, and so on and so forth. So,
for example, you know, that what you said now just hit me. For example, as a young adult, I could decide to adopt maybe kids in a class in maybe a college or a school,
yeah,
and decide maybe 10 of you or 15 of you, I want to group mentor you,
yeah,
because I've been through what you've been through,
yeah,
and I see that as a potential bright future.
Absolutely.
For you.
Yeah. And you know, I like what Miles Monroe says again.
Yeah.
He says, you see, mentorship is the highest form of maturity. It demonstrates security. An insecure person will never mentor another person. So mentorship, this mentor mindset, it demonstrates your maturity. It's the highest form of maturity because you want to reproduce yourself.
And you know, it's once you get this mentor mindset, I believe it encourages you to further develop yourself and grow.
Yeah.
I mean, naturally, if you have decided that I'm going to identify potential, I'm going to try to work to help mold another person's future, you'll be forced to invest in yourself.
Absolutely.
To upgrade your knowledge, to upgrade your skills, which will benefit you.
Absolutely.
And then also the person that you've decided,
yeah,
to help.
You see, in my journey of mentorship, I found that, you know, by mentoring others, I find myself developing more.
Absolutely.
Because if I'm mentoring a young person who reads a lot of books, for instance, they read, and then I have a mentorship session with them. You see, it also puts a challenge on me to also read. So there is that mutual benefit as you are mentoring. And you know, the challenge I would give people shared with, Jesus left the 12 disciples as, you know, mentees, all right? We can talk about poor Timothy. Paul can point at Timothy, all right? But then you, as someone who has made it, who can you point at to have made that?
That's deep. That's deep. So
yeah.
Now, I'm ready to go on the mentorship journey. I understand the ways I can mentor. How do I overcome the fear of mentoring others?
All right. So overcoming that fear, of course, you have to recognize the importance of mentorship.
Yeah.
Like I said, I'm a product of mentorship. If something benefited me, definitely, I should also do the same to another person. So I need to overcome that fear by recognizing the benefit which I've enjoyed.
Absolutely. And also, I think, you know, you need to also recognize that you have inherent value and worth.
Yeah.
You always have something in your hand that God can use. You know, we're told clearly you have a spirit of power, of love, and of a sound mind, and not one of fear.
Absolutely.
So you, yeah, need to engage that in overcoming any reservations or concerns you might have about mentoring others.
But now, Sheb, what age can you... At what age do you think you can start? Yeah,
especially since you brought in that, you know, that that topic around maturity.
Yeah.
You know, I think maturity and age and mentorship, I don't really see a relationship completely.
Yeah.
You know, of course, there's a certain level of independence I believe you should have achieved.
Yeah.
Before you are in a place where you have gathered enough experience.
Yeah.
You have gathered enough experiences. Now, when we say experiences, sometimes people think I have to be old and bearded and whatnot. No. Your experiences are valuable. You have inherent value and worth.
Yeah.
So I don't think that there is any specific age, but of course, a certain level of independence needs to have been achieved. And that level of independence could be achieved at 18, 19, 20.
Yeah.
It's unique per individual.
Yeah. Yeah. It reminds me of the work setup. You see, sometimes we have people we report to who,
yes,
are like much older than you.
Yes.
Oh, maybe younger. All right. So when you have such people ahead of you, I mean, you don't do age. By the way, they say age is a number. I think I believe that. You find you know, your boss is so young, much younger than you, and you won't say, no, this one is younger, I can't report. No, you missed the point. But you see, mentorship is about, you know, this experience that you have acquired, this maturity. Look at even the Lord Jesus Christ. When he started ministry, he was just 30. And then there are others who say, oh, I'm too young. But look at what the Bible talks about, you know, young leaders. Yeah. So I think
at any age.
At any age. Yeah. But then the other question that you may ask yourself is it possible to mentor others without you knowing?
You know, that's a good question, but then I don't think it's possible, because mentorship is an active activity. You may not call what you're doing mentorship if you're not actively engaging your mind in it. I think once you recognize that you want to enter a mentorship relationship with somebody, there is a need. I think it's you're required to make the effort to make it active. Of course, we can be inspired. So if I flip it around, there are many people that inspire us from afar. You know, I like the way that person dresses. I like the way Pastor Kondwani, for example, preaches, you know. That is from afar.
I like the way Pastor Walker teaches.
Exactly. That is from afar. But a mentorship relationship needs active involvement of the mentor to a large extent so that it is profitable. If we use the example of the greatest mentor, he called them and says, I will make you. I will make you into something. So that he engaged them on that level. So I think it's not possible to not be aware. If it's a true mentor.
So from the point of view of a mentor, you need to actively engage. All right. So from the mentee point of view, there are many people who inspire you, who, because you see, we look at, we view mentorship from three angles, which is a consultant, a counselor, and a cheerleader. So you find that there's some people who just, maybe based on what they have written, if they've written books, you are able to make certain decisions based on what they have written. Or maybe they teach, like maybe you come to church and then Pastor Walker is teaching, or Pastor Kondwani, or Pastor Benjamin, or, you know, you make decisions based on what they say. So you're kind of consulting them. But what you're talking about is that as a mentor, right, the mentor mindset, you must be intentional about mentorship. So then, Shegu, what are the keys to being a successful mentor?
So to really address this and maybe help wrap up the message on that, I think if there's anything you're going to take away from the discussion today on the mentor mindset, there are three things I want to leave you with. Three keys. We'll call them the three T's.
Three T's.
Of successful mentorship. It's not an exhaustive list, but hopefully it will be easy to remember as you get started on the mentorship journey. The first is time. You need to invest time in the mentorship relationship, which is why I think for me it needs to be an active relationship. Jesus spent a lot of time with his disciples. They slept in the same places. They moved around in the same times. And afterwards, people could look at them and tell that these ones have been with Jesus Christ. So time needs to be intentional and planned in the mentorship relationship. The second T, I think, is transparency. Jesus spoke to the crowds in parables, but he said to his disciples, it is given to you to know the secrets of the kingdom. Matthew 13:11. But for those who are outside, we'll speak to them in stories. You need to be transparent to the people that you're mentoring, because you have something of value to give them, but it should be quite clear to them as you develop that mentorship relationship. That transparency needs to be there. The third T, and I think maybe the most important T, is truth. There's a liberating power in knowing the truth. As a mentor, you should speak the truth to your mentee. People select mentors based on what they might have seen you achieve. They might look up to you. Or, as we've said earlier, you see potential and you hear of people of good report. I think it's important that you tell your mentors the truth about the journey that you are guiding them on, whether even if it's from a counseling point of view, a consultative point of view, or from a cheerleading point of view, that this is what the real issues you will face are. So that truth has to be there. So three T's: you need to spend time, you need to be transparent, and you need to tell them the truth.
All right. Okay. I like the way you've summed it up, and I think it kind of ties in with the earlier segment which I brought up. You see, mentorship is the highest form of maturity. So I think a mature believer, a mature person, is expected to mentor others.
Absolutely.
You find time to do that. You're transparent about it. and you're truthful in what you're doing. So there could be one person or someone out there right now who is listening to this message. And then where do they start from in this journey?
Yeah, so I think there was something that you touched on, which is very important. Maturity, and as a mature believer. Jesus speaking to the disciples says, I go away, and because I go away, you will do greater works than I do.
Yeah.
But then the first thing is they had a relationship with him.
With him.
So the first place to start with somebody who's listening to this today and is asking, okay, now I want to be a mentor. I think it's first important you connect with the greatest mentor
at
the time. You need to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. You need to know him for yourself, and he needs to be known. He needs to be known to you as well. So I'm going to invite you, if you're listening to this, you've never entered a relationship with Jesus Christ. You've never said these words that we're going to say shortly, asking him to come into your life and to be Lord of your life, asking him to save you and confessing with your mouth. It's important you do this. I'm going to lead you in a short prayer right now. Say this prayer, and afterwards, please just drop a comment. Say anything in the Facebook chat, Facebook chat or the YouTube chat. Just leave a comment, and someone will definitely reach out to you. Yeah. So just please say this prayer with me. Lord Jesus, I recognize that you are God and King.
I recognize that you are God and King.
And I want to enter a relationship with you today. So I confess with my mouth. That you died and you were rose again from the dead. For my sin. So I ask you to come into my life today. Be the Lord. And Savior of me. And from today onwards. I accept your Lordship and rule over my life. In Jesus' name. So that's it. So please leave a comment. We'd like to get in touch with you and continue this conversation as we help you on the mentorship journey.
Yeah. So what has happened right now is this great joy and celebration in heaven. For that one soul that has given their lives to the Lord, there's a party in heaven. So I think we would like to thank you most especially for joining us this afternoon. I hope you had a wonderful time. And I think as we go into the small groups,
yes,
those from MLFC, from the merge small groups. So we encourage you to go in the small groups and be able to discuss this topic and see how you apply it.
Yeah. Your leaders will be engaging you shortly with some discussion points so that we can expand on this a bit further in your small groups. And importantly, don't forget, share this video.
Yeah.
Send the links to your friend, put it on your WhatsApp status. Host a watch party even.
Yeah.
And make sure this message gets out to as many people as possible.
All right. So we'll see you next week for another exciting topic. Bye-bye.
All right, then.